welcome everyone to our second open of the Center for Global Ethics and Politics this spring semester. And as usual, the event will be followed by a reception down on the floor with lots of wine and beer. So you'll be able to join us there. I'm delighted to have as our speaker Kristin, Surak of the University of London, so that school, whom I was lucky enough to get to know at the Institute for Advanced Study, where we were both members last year. Kristin has a large body of work and a wide range.
To the U.S.'s EB-5 program that is the U.S. sells residents to. for a business investment of just $500,000 in an area of high unemployment, so Beverly Hills counts, you can get an EB-5 visa, which gives the right to live in the U.S. and to apply for a green card after just 2 years. And with that in hand, and a minimum number of days spent in the U.S., you can apply for citizenship after 3 years. Now, many people don't want to wait. Fortunately for them, a number of countries have done away with tedious residence requirements. For an investment of 2 million euros, you can get citizenship in Cyprus for the whole family within 90 days and without ever setting foot in the country. Five Caribbean islands offer the same for around $100,000 to $200,000. That's the new price after Antigua had a fire sale on citizenship last year. So there's quite a lot to choose from these days when it comes to citizenship products, which is striking, because few statuses are as arbitrary yet influential for determining one's life chances as citizenship. Over a century ago, inequality within countries was greater than inequality between them. That is, the gap between the richest and poorest Americans was much greater than the gap between, say, the Americans and the Argentinians. Now the situation is reversed. No one chooses their parents, nor where they're from, but even the poorest Danes are doing far better and living much longer than the average Burundian. To have been born in Copenhagen rather than Bujumbura is, in the words of political theorist Eilert Schachar, akin to winning the birthright lottery. Within this field, the spread of economic citizenship programs, I will argue, is a critical site for understanding broader transformations in citizenship and inequality today. Traditionally, academic studies of citizenship attribution have staked their territory as bounded between two poles, that is, jus soli on one end and jus sanguinis on the other. Countries drawing on the law of the soil are typically characterized as more civic and open in national definition, while those relying on blood are more ethnic and closed in orientation. And then the debates concern the determinants of choice, whether prior legal practices, cultural idioms, ideological orientations, or what have you, affect the size of immigration flows. The reality, though, is much more mixed. The U.S. is often taken as a paradigmatic jus soli case. If you're born in America, you're given U.S. citizenship. But the U.S. also extends citizenship to children born of nationals residing abroad, effectively jus sanguinis. Similarly, prototypical jus sanguinis countries like Japan will give citizenship to orphans found on its territory, jus soli. Furthermore, citizenship is regularly extended on grounds far more diverse, including marriage, adoption, cultural affinity, public service, and military service. Die serving in the American Army, and you can get post-mortem citizenship. Exchanging citizenship for financial investments, what might be termed jus pecuniae, is just one of these. So today, I'll attempt to advance a more comprehensive account of jus pecuniae, looking at the distinctive properties of citizenship as a commodity. I'll propose a typology of its contemporary forms. I'll provide an account of its emergence and operation in practice. And I'll discuss the implications for our understanding of citizenship and inequality more broadly. To date, scholarship on investor citizenship has been split into roughly two sorts. On the one hand are the economists, who typically regard citizenship as little different from anything else that can be commodified and traded on the market. The Becker example I brought up earlier is paradigmatic of this sort of approach. For the economists, not surprisingly, selling citizenship is seen as the most egalitarian and efficient way to screen people for membership in a nation, and a price mechanism is seen as the best method to control flows. Quibbling, in a sense, comes down to program design. To maximize per capita income, a country might set up a price system with specific targets for immigration, or it might use an auction to do the same. But the bottom line in this line of thinking is that being able and willing to pay, those who are willing and able to pay, also will have the desirable characteristics, being young, skilled, educated, and talented, that any nation would want. Now, on the other hand, and in great contrast, lie apprehensive legal and political theorists. They stand pretty much aghast. How could you possibly give migrant millionaires who may never have even entered a country in the first place the right to vote and a stake in the political community? Their trepidation draws from two sources. First, an Aristotelian conception of citizenship that sees political involvement as its foundation. separate spheres. That is, inequalities in the sphere of money should not map onto those of political participation. As such, to sell membership represents a fundamental threat to citizenship as an institution based on equality and participation. Violated is the crucial link of jus nexi, a genuine connection that both roots political membership and ensures that participants are genuine stakeholders. If voting in elections is the core political right of citizenship, then selling passports is akin to selling political influence, a danger that could reinforce inequality within society. Putting a price tag on membership in the body politic restricts its benefits only to the elites, and only to elites at the cost of equality, both within a state and internationally. Now, despite their normative differences, the economic and political legal strands of voting share a key limitation. That is, both accounts typically presume that citizen investors hope to immigrate to and eventually settle in their country. It's the investor as immigrant that produces either economic gains or democratic threats. Yet, a straight-line migration trajectory rarely applies to those purchasing second passports outright. Most buyers lead rather transnational lives and are looking for mobility and security rather than settlement. There are Taiwanese living in Hong Kong with Canadian passports, or Egyptians in Dubai with Dominican papers. Furthermore, the price mechanism that economists tout has actually a fairly poor track record for regulating supply and demand on a terrain defined by essentially shifting geopolitics and legal protocols. So when Canada doubled the cost of its investor visa in 1999 and doubled it again in 2010, application numbers continued to outpace it. Not because of what was happening in Canada, but because of what was happening in China. The result was a backlog of over 60,000 applications when the main program was closed in 2014. One might also add that the image of investor as immigrant warps analysis of her impact on democracy. Countries with formal citizenship by investment programs all maintain physical presence requirements for electoral participation. To cast a vote, one must be resident for several months prior to an election. The stipulation not only disqualifies the investor citizens who aren't there, but also, and more importantly, the substantial diaspora populations as well. So the 30,000 Grenadians living in the US, which is a pretty sizable number for an island with a population of just over 100,000, would need to return to their homeland for 12 months before qualifying to vote. These largely disembedded arguments of the economists and political theorists turn brittle when they confront what is really happening on the ground. This empirical work is needed to push forward the theoretical engagement of jus pecuniae. Though what some have called the, quote, brute and unfettered cash for passport exchanges may occur, the full story is far more complex. And in considering it, allows a reconsidered understanding of citizenship and its operation in contemporary times. So break it down and start looking at citizenship as a commodity. So citizenship for many migrants comes at a significant financial cost. At minimum, they pay fees to brokers, lawyers, and governments as a matter of course. But as a commodity, essentially a product or residence planning that is sold on the market, citizenship possesses two notable properties. The first is the role of the state. Economic sociologists emphasize that markets operate in a political space that states define by setting the rules and regulations of economic action. In the case of citizenship, however, the modern state serves not merely as a key regulator, but also the sole producer of the good. And almost uniquely so in the contemporary world. Sovereign debt would be the other example. Furthermore, the state is the only legitimate end seller of citizenship. So even where there are chains of middlemen. This is because the status is fundamentally a relationship between sovereign and subject. And as such, there can be no legal secondary market. Meaning that I can't sell my citizenship on to someone else without the recognition of the sovereign. This double role of the state as both regulator and producer-seller has at times yielded rather dubious yet perfectly perfectly legal cases of countries selling citizenship to criminals. Without an external watchman, this sort of configuration, however, can foster conflicts of interest. And this has encouraged states in search of legitimacy to detach the two roles and outsource elements of review and supervision to external due diligence firms and other sorts of third-party actors. So second, the thing about citizenship as a commodity, product differentiation marks this realm. Not all versions are equal. The use value of citizenship we can think of as the rights and privileges that it offers its holder. This is set along two vectors, internal and external. Historically, the internal side has received the most attention, which is evident in the enormous literature on the benefits that citizenship extends, or doesn't, to members within, and conversely, what non-members are unable to access. But its use value does not end at the national border. Citizenship secures benefits outside the state as well. Here, of course, reputation plays no small part. People with more prestigious citizenships benefit when abroad from the stature accorded to their country, and of course, vice versa. But for global movers, however, the more immediate concern is mobility itself. And on this measure, the most powerful passports, those from Germany and, for the moment, the UK, allow their holders to enter over 170 countries without obtaining a visa in advance. Simply turn up at the airport and you're in. The worst, Iraq and Afghanistan, will get their holder easy admission to less than 30 countries. But more than mere access to other states, citizenship can secure benefits within them, as members of regional clubs know very well. I have a French passport, but in Germany my rights are those of most Germans. I can invest, build businesses, claim welfare provisions, and even enjoy some voting rights. Possessing EU citizenship is akin to possessing citizenship in 27 countries. And the EU is not alone. We find similar regional clubs in the GCC, in the Middle East, in ECOWAS in Africa, CARICOM in the Caribbean, Mercosur in South America, as well as the Nordic Council. All give expansive benefits to citizens of member countries. Bilateral agreements, like those between France and Monaco or Lesotho in South Africa, can have the same effect, extending the benefits of citizenship beyond the territory of the nation state. These alliances form to encourage the free flow of capital goods in the first instance and labor in the second, operate as federation-like clubs that grant rights and privileges to mobile individuals by virtue of membership, not the region, but within a constituent country. The result is that, for an Egyptian, citizenship in Dominica is valuable not for what it gets her in Dominica, but for visa-free access to Europe. For a Burmese businessman, citizenship in Cyprus opens investment opportunities in Germany and access to the US. As a residence planning tool, citizenship is the right to more rights. Because the use value of citizenship is set not only internally but also externally, the granting government does not hold exclusive influence over it. Foreign states can curtail its worth by forbidding access to or restricting rights within them. So for example, in 2014, Canada revoked visa-free access to St. Kitts after two Iranian businessmen turned up with diplomatic passports but without diplomatic business. The result was a blow to the utility of condition travel documents for all who hold them, as well as it did in passport sales. So the result is that external powers can also not only decrease, but also increase the utility of citizenship. When Poland entered the EU, for example, it saw a surge in citizenship applications from Israel. Because third countries, to a great degree, determined the use value of citizenship, states with formal citizenship by powers typically try to maintain good relationship with regional powers. When they make policy changes, they always talk to Washington or Brussels first. Before I go on with the actual the way this field sort of operates, I'd like to offer two quick caveats in terms of the sort of theoretical space and empirical space I'm operating in. The first concerns rights and duties. So we should keep in mind that the duties we typically associate with citizenship aren't really limited to citizens for the most part. Taxes are paid by everybody, even short-term visitors pay sales tax, Conscript armies are on the decline, foreign mercenaries are increasingly common again. And in the US, only jury duty really remains in the hands of citizens, and then only for citizens resident in the country. I've lived outside the US for many years, and I haven't had to serve on a jury in ages. The sociologist H. Marshall observed half a century ago that, on balance, the rights of citizenship were becoming superseding its duties, and this is a trend that has continued. Furthermore, it's important to keep in mind dual citizenship. This does not absolutely determine whether or not citizenship can be bought or sold, but having dual citizenship provisions helps. So if we look at demand, we can find plenty of examples in the Chinese. They're the largest group of consumers of second passports, the second passport industry, but dual citizenship is forbidden by Beijing. But it's also the case of supply. So between 1920 and 1955, Liechtenstein sold citizenship, though it did not allow dual citizens. So it helps to have dual citizenship provisions, but they do not ultimately determine the course of things. To go back and start thinking about what this market for citizenship looks like, I'd like to describe a couple of the products types available. The first type are immigrant investor visas, then come discretionary economic citizenship, and then finally I'll talk about citizenship by investment programs, which is really what I'm mainly interested in, but it's important to think about this within this wider field. So immigrant investor visas offer a pathway to residence or permanent residence based on financial contributions, and this may or may not lead to citizenship. These sorts of visa schemes are extremely common. Around 70 countries offer such programs, including America's EB-5, the British Investor and Entrepreneur visas, Australian Significant Investor visas, Panamanian Reforestation visa. French have a program, the Portuguese have a program that's gotten quite a lot of news coverage, the Dutch, Singapore. My personal favorite is the Brazilian Permanent Residence Visa Investment Program, also known as VIPER. In addition to this, in a sense buying a permanent residence, countries may also grant citizenship in exchange for financial contributions in a discretionary manner. This is very common as well. If you give the government of Panama enough money, it will give you a passport in return, as will Nauru in the Pacific, and even recently I learned Japan will do this too. In Europe, Austria, for example, will give citizenship to individuals who have accorded the country exceptional economic benefits, typically amounting to about 2 million to 10 million euros. But in these cases, the expectations remain undefined and highly personalized. The result is more of a practice rather than a formal program. This is a little bit different to what I mean by citizenship by investment schemes. These two grant citizenship in exchange for financial contributions, but a clearly delineated program. Time frame, cost schedule, investment options, due diligence expectations are plainly specified by a formal and relatively transparent policy that can be replicated. We see this in several Caribbean countries, St. Kitts, Antigua, Dominica, Grenada, St. Lucia most recently offer such programs, and in the Mediterranean, Malta and Cyprus, with Montenegro probably coming online before the end of the year this year. Now, if we look at what you're getting with these different sorts of programs, we can think about the field by looking across columns as well as at types, both in terms of the degree of formality. We can look at differences in terms of rights and privileges, keeping in mind that even though the rights of permanent residents in many countries have become close to those secured by citizens, there are still a few couple of differences that matter. Citizens can't be deported, citizens cannot be refused entry to their own country, and citizenship is inheritable, which is important if you're wealthy. It's also a passport rather than a visa in your passport, which can make a difference if you have a so-called bad passport. You can also look at the differences in times to citizenship as well, even though this may not always be a goal of a person making one of these purchases. You can also look at the different sorts of residence requirements, which can vary quite a bit. One may or may not need to be in a country for a certain number of days. So in Latvia, you have to be in the country one day per year to keep up your permanent residence. In Bulgaria, there's no requirement. The US, UK, you have to usually be in the country 180 days each year, becoming a tax resident before you can apply for citizenship. Plus, some countries don't use physical presence, but jurisdictional presence, which is metaphysical. So to set up a residence in Malta, you join some clubs, give to some charities, write a nice essay about how you'll make the country your residence, and then you go back to your mansion in South Kensington in London. Then we can also think about the financial contributions required. These can come in a couple of different forms. The most prominent are government donations, which you don't get back, but they can also come in the form of investments, which you usually do get back. These are typically low-yield government bonds or private sector assets like businesses or real estate. And then finally, we can ask questions about the financial impact of these sorts of programs. In large countries, US, UK, Canada, it's negligible. It's not even a drop in the bucket, because these are small numbers of people in huge economies as well. And on top of it, most people cash out as soon as they can. But the economic impact in small countries is absolutely enormous. In Dominica and Antigua, citizenship sales account for nearly 15% of GDP. In St. Kitts, it's now nearly 40% of GDP. It's almost like, okay, the population of Antigua is about 80,000. Yes, it's the size of a small town. So it doesn't take much. But it's hugely important for these governments. And given these potential economic benefits to microstates, it's unsurprising that citizenship by investment is on the rise. How do we get here? Looking at the birth of citizenship by investment begins in the 1980s with the spread of discretionary economic citizenship. Microstates in the Pacific began selling citizenship to Chinese clients, seeking greater freedom of travel as well as the advantages of tax havens. They also were looking over their shoulder very often at the return of Hong Kong to the mainland. Between 1982 and 2002, those 20 years, countries including Nauru, Vanuatu, Tonga, over there, don't really think about them very well, sold an estimated 14,000 passports for anywhere between $4,000 to about $50,000 each. These sales, though, were discretionary in my typology. They were largely secretive and defined by enormous amounts of ambiguity. So Tonga, for example, revised the law in 1984 to give the king full discretion to naturalize foreigners. What happened? Middlemen opened up shop in Hong Kong and sold over 8,000 passports outside the knowledge of the Tongan immigration office. The proceeds of the sales, an estimated $20 million, ended up in Tonga, but in bank accounts in North America. When news got out, unprecedented public protests brought down the prime minister, and that's pretty much the largest and most effective form of opposition that's occurred in terms of these programs. Now, this kind of shady business wasn't too unusual at the time for the region. International criminals were showing up in airports with Nauru and Vanuatu documents, and even Imelda Marcos bought one just in case. And on top of all this, thousands of passports were printed but then went missing. Now, though the bulk of the sales was in the Pacific, countries elsewhere began to follow suit. 1984, St. Kitts added a channel for use of CUNY in its Citizenship Act, just 1 year after independence from the UK. Lesotho in Southern Africa started selling citizenship from its consulate in Hong Kong. Belize and Grenada opened up discretionary channels until the US pressured them to stop following September 11th. And even Ireland started a fiscal naturalization stream in 1989, with this claim that money created Irish associations. However, the government closed it after 10 years, citing problems with fraud and the difficulty of showing any economic benefits of these sorts of programs. If you look at some of the parliamentary debates at the time, it can give you a sense of what I mean by the discretionary character of these sorts of schemes. The scheme was apparently perfectly legal in that it broke no law, but the basis for it was not set down either in the form of legislation or ministerial order. It worked entirely within the scope of the discretion of available to the minister of the day under the nationality and citizenship legislation. It came into being with an informality that is quite staggering, particularly in view of the importance of the issues involved. There seem to have been no rules governing the scheme at all. And this is from one of the MPs who was lobbying to close the program. So throughout the 80s and 90s, the sale of citizenship, that is discretionary economic citizenship, remained a pretty murky business, and one involving only small countries on the periphery, with the arguable exception of Ireland. But the global core was not going to be left out. By the late 80s and early 90s, economic powerhouses would get involved, but in a slightly different way, offering not citizenship, but permanent residence. You still actually had to do the time in the country. Here, Canada, long a leader in migration policy innovation, paved the way. In 1978, it opened a business immigration scheme, which it recrafted in 1986 into the Federal Immigrant Investor Program, which really kicked things off in the global war. How did it work? In the early years, an applicant demonstrated a net worth of $500,000 and committed to invest a minimum of $250,000 in a Canadian business. And these price points would increase over the years to eventually reach an investment of $800,000 and showing evidence of a net worth of $1.6 million. So in exchange for this, the applicant would get a conditional residence visa that became a permanent residence after 3 years. And permanent residence was almost always granted, no matter how the businesses people were investing in were doing. What's interesting here as well is that processing the applications were three leading banks, which basically worked out financing options, which would lower the final cost to about 100,000 or so Canadian dollars. They would basically loan you, you would basically pay the interest on the money loaned out. The result was a hugely popular program that produced over 200,000 new Canadians or permanent residents. Other states began to take note. The US jumped on board in 1990 with its EB-5 program. The UK formulated its own in 1994, and a number of other countries followed suit. But outside of Canada, figures remained very small. In some years, the UK had only a couple of dozen applicants. Furthermore, the economic impact has been trivial. As I mentioned before, these are huge economies. The figures are just drops in a bucket. There's loads of workarounds that prevent any sort of real investment from occurring. So banks will loan you the money, so you're just paying interest and fees. Sometimes the business papers are just sold over and over to new investors, with no new businesses being created. And of course, people withdraw the investment . So it's within this field of the emergence of discretionary economic channels in the periphery and investor visa programs in the core that formal citizenship by investment schemes would be able to find their place. The story starts here in the Caribbean. In 2005, the island of St. Kitts was in a bind. It had closed down sugar production, which was its traditional mainstay, and was desperately looking for something to sustain the economy. Vacationing in the region was the now leader of Henley & Partners, a Swiss firm which, at the time, arranged European residents for the global elite, basically in Switzerland. He saw a business opportunity and approached the government about restructuring its discretionary economic citizenship channel into a formal program. The result? For a donation of $200,000 to the government at the time, now it's $250,000, or for a real estate investment of $400,000, plus about $50,000 in processing fees, and a background check, you can become a conditioned citizen in about 90 days. You don't even need to go to the country. In reworking the channel, the government moved the program above the board. It set up a private entity to handle donations and created a list of approved investment options. It developed a system for licensing citizenship agents. The government also contracted Henley & Partners to promote its program internationally, and in exchange, Henley received a generous 10% of every approved donation, which when you start adding up the numbers is pretty sizable. It's which is also a pretty good incentive to invest in advertising. So Henley started citizenship conferences, bought space in The Economist, set up international passport rankings, and even created a global citizen board and founded a global citizen magazine. But most importantly, it promoted the program among personal wealth managers, as well as global banks and accounting firms, which would then line up petition citizenship alongside investor visas in places like Canada. Citizenship in St. Kitts was no longer a murky venture, but a legitimate option. And importantly, one that wouldn't raise warning flags for the risk divisions of international banks and accounting firms. Then, in 2009, came the big bonus. St. Kitts got visa-free access to the EU, which is a valuable proposition to any Russian oligarch or Chinese nouveau riche. And with this, we see the emergence of parity. Financial planners working with clients, looking to get citizenship in Canada, for example, which would take about 6 years, would put their clients first on a condition passport while they waited. And this sort of pairing has since become an industry standard. And it's a great financial success for St. Kitts. So this is the growth in naturalizations through the Citizenship by Investment Program from about 20 in 2006 to over 2,000 last year, or 2 years ago. It's kind of recovered to about 2014 numbers. In the year 2006, the program receipts were about 1% of GDP. Now they're around 38, approaching 40% of GDP. Processing of fees alone account for 7% of GDP, which far outstrips manufacturing on the island, which is a mere 5%. Now this model, crafted by Henley and partners and promoted by them as well, has quickly spread in a region of microstates with little economic basis beyond tourism. Antigua and Grenada developed similar programs in 2013. In 2014, Dominica revamped its long-standing discretionary channel into a formal program, and in January of last year, St. Lucia got on board as well. The Mediterranean, too, has become a center of sales. Henley took its model to Malta, which started a program in 2013, which secures EU citizenship for a combined donation and investment of about 1.2 million euros. Malta joined Cyprus, which since 2007 has revamped its discretionary economic citizenship program into a formal program. Cyprus offers EU citizenship now for, it was 2.5 million up until a couple of months ago, now it's cut the prices again to about 2 million. Which is more than Malta, but you can also cash out. Plus, you get the whole family in for 2 million, and the process is much quicker. The result of all of this is pretty big business. Bloomberg estimates that $2 billion were spent on citizenship planning in 2015. But to understand how we got to this point, we need to look beyond the sort of blanket generalizations about neoliberalism and marketization of everything, in order to understand, you know, what are the specific field dynamics that allowed it to emerge, as well as the distinct historical juncture that produced it as well. First, we have to take into account the institutional environment. The spread of discretionary economics, discretionary channels paved the way for citizenship by investment. They gave service providers working with government something to retool into a more transparent programs. Simultaneously, investor visas, diffusing among poor countries and beyond, regularized residence planning for the new mass affluent. Banks and wealth managers lined up citizenship by investment programs alongside investor visas, even pairing them as legitimate options to maximize mobility and flexibility. In terms of supply, we see this driven by residence planning agencies on one hand and the governments of microstates on the other, both of which are looking to capitalize on membership. And now that workable models are available, it's relatively easy for new countries to come on board. They just cut and paste the program, and we see this over and over again. In terms of demand, it's continuing apace with the generation of new wealth outside the global core. Hong Kong was the mainspring, where the combination of freewheeling capitalism plus uncertainty around the handover to China produced a moneyed, yet possibly immobile elite. New wealth looking for options to hedge its bets and was looking for options to hedge its bets and secure its future. In former Soviet states, the second largest market, commodity wealth, state privatizations, and financial turbulence define the shift from communism to capitalism into the present. We also see new wealth paired with bad passports and uncertainty about the ruling regime. In the Middle East, we see war, oil, trade, and sanctions generating a third regional center of wealthy individuals in search of security, mobility, and insurance policy. That is, the end of the Cold War and the so-called triumph of capitalism have resulted in new configurations of wealth and inequality outside traditional poor states that continue to produce eager buyers of additional passports. And I should say that the new wealth element is very important because usually by the second generation, very wealthy people have secured some sort of solution, a passport solution. The global population of high net worth individuals is growing between 7% and 14% annually. And by 2014, the Asia Pacific region had edged out North America and now hosts the largest population of high net worth individuals, due largely to Chinese and Indian accumulation of wealth among the richest class. So here's the growth by region of high net worth individuals, and here is the growth of their wealth. With North America, you can still see more wealth in North America than anywhere else, but Asia Pacific is rapidly catching up. Now, of course, these transformations have not gone undisputed. As I mentioned before, regional players like the European Union or United States have actively pressured countries, either closing down programs or compelling their revision. But challenges can arise within states as well. Opposition parties typically liken the program to cash cows for the party in power, and local media typically lash out at governments for carelessly prostituting the nation or siphoning funds from the programs, which happens quite a bit. In election years, citizenship by investment is always a hot button issue. But regime change does not bring program change. In Grenada, the opposition won elections in 2013, in Antigua in 2014, in St. Kitts in 2015. Yet no newly elected party has implemented pre-election promises to end these programs, which have become a vital source of revenue. Public opinion, there have been no good public opinion polls yet, but they range from critical to reluctantly supportive. Average folks are worried, and rightly so, that these programs will compromise their own access to the US and elsewhere. And this is a serious concern, especially in countries with large diaspora populations. It's not always easy or very cheap to apply for a visa to the US. But in no place have we seen the sort of street protests that occurred in Tonga, now government. This wraps into the final point about legitimacy. With the rise of formal citizenship by investment programs, this has made reputation a key concern. And for small islands with little beyond tourism, the stakes are quite high. Yet the value of the product is determined for the most part externally. The result is that the legitimacy of the programs in the eyes of the global north takes on critical importance both for governments and service providers profiting from the sales. The result has been a push for greater transparency, a return to independent due diligence checks, and the emergence of standards boards to protect the reputation of the programs. That is, we see the field becoming both routinized and increasingly complex. So, what do these transformations mean for citizenship more broadly? Rather than aberrations, use community and its attendants, I would argue, are best understood as opportune sites for both destabilizing common assumptions about citizenship and exploring broader. So the first one concerns citizenship and strategic action. I'm not the only person to make this sort of point these days, but it bears emphasizing. Citizenship in the world of nation states has long held a quasi-sacred status. That is, to be born a man without a country, and Everett Edmund Hale's famous phrase, was a fate worse than death. Moreover, initially the status was to be unique. Dual citizenship and dual loyalties were avoided at all costs, hence the frequent bans on matrimonial citizenship. This has changed dramatically in recent years. Whereas in the 1950s, only about 5 countries recognized dual citizenship, over 50 did by 2005, and nearly half of all countries do so today. Dual citizenship once threatened divided loyalties. Now it yields options. elite Turks travel to the U.S. to give birth in hope of securing choices for their children. Argentines find Italian ancestors to gain rights to work in Barcelona. It's an era of citizenship a la carte, as sociologist David Fitzgerald has called it. This people are ever more strategic about multizenship as the right to more rights. These trends are both a cause and consequence of the thinning of citizenship, what Kristin has termed citizenship light. But even faded citizenship has not lost all color. Antigua requires an oath sworn in its capital city. Malta includes a little citizenship ceremony when you purchase it. And the Prime Minister of St. Lucia declares his hope that all new economic citizens will develop a genuine connection with the island. But overall, it's an increasingly instrumental, over-effective action that structures many citizenship choices, and not only for the global elite, but as memberships have their privileges. Citizenship, in this industry, we also see the increasing importance of third-party actors. So in conventional accounts, citizenship policy reflects unique national circumstances, at least for its core modern, core concerns in the constitution of sovereignty. That is, it connects the individual to the state that rules in her name, and as such, may be surprising to find out that foreign governments and private firms can decisively affect citizenship policy. For third-party governments, like the EU, like members of the EU or the United States, interventions have been largely reactive and revisionist. We see this in the pressure that the US and Brussels has exerted to end discretionary economic citizenship channels or to amend citizenship by investment programs. But on the world scene, of course, microstates are not without some leverage. So CARICOM holds 15 votes in the UN, Malta and Cyprus have full veto privileges in the EU. Nonetheless, regional giants continue to hold sway over the islands in their periphery, enough to see citizenship laws struck or rewritten, even in the absence of legal dictate. If third-party states have been largely reactive, businesses have been very proactive. Indeed, since their inception, citizenship by investment schemes have been inseparable from their key service providers, which build programs, bring new citizens to government, and connect a broad array of businesses into a networked migration industry. When it comes to cross-border mobility, it is of course quite common for private actors to implement immigration policies. Countries like G4S deal with visas, detention centers are privatized, airlines checkouts. But here in Citizenship by Investment, we find dominant consultancies not only implementing policy, but intimately involved in formulating law. These firms, with legal templates and best practices in hand, promote the spread of citizenship by investment programs to new countries. The overall result goes beyond the client politics often involved in immigration policy formation. It resembles more the close relationship between Washington policymakers and K Street. Where think tanks and lobbying groups, to an ever greater extent, produce policy blueprints for lawmakers to implement bold law. CARICOM is a specific form of private ordering, whereby private actors generate templates that governments adopt and then subsequently delegate to private agencies to implement. Citizenship policy has not been immune from this trend. Citizenship by investment programs provide an opening to reconsider questions of inequality as well that exceed the interrogation of import of how the wealthy buy privilege. This is, of course, commonly one would expect this. For scholars of citizenship, a focus on inequality as well is hardly new. It stretches back to T.H. Marshall's analysis of political membership and social class. The sale of citizenship, however, reminds us that it's not merely inequalities within states that matter. Disparities between states also play a crucial role in producing the value of citizenship as a product. Demand for passports will remain strong as long as countries outside the global core produce wealthy citizens seeking improved mobility or an insurance policy against their own government. Microstates, too, with limited revenue sources, will continue to look to citizenship options, capitalizing on something that all states have, jurisdiction. As they're not selling sovereignty that only lies with the state, what they're doing is capitalizing on jurisdiction. Because the value of citizenship as a commodity is set outside the country selling it, the sanction of poor states is essential for formal channels to redeem their value. This St. Kitts learned the hard way when dealing with Canada, Brexit raises many questions about the desirability of a Maltese passport, and should the Schengen zone break up, a scenario no longer difficult to imagine, the value of formal economic citizenship in small countries will drop. Recognition of external, both geopolitical and political economic determinants of the value of citizenship as a commodity is crucial for understanding the limits and dynamics of the citizenship market. It is inequality rather than equality among both among individuals and among countries that defines the worth of citizenship. It's both the regional concentration of the growth of ultra-wealthy outside of the global poor, as well as the limits of the passports that they have. This is the Henley & Partners Visa Restriction Index showing Germany and Sweden's two of the best passports to have, giving the access to most countries visa-free, and Pakistan and Afghanistan are some of the worst. Russia is ranked 48, India is 85, China is 87, Syria is 100, Iraq is 102. These are the key points in the citizenship market. The final point I want to make involves citizenship and territory. Conventionally, to naturalize as a citizen, one must first move to the prospective country. Even foreign spouses of nationals typically must first pick up sticks and move there. And indeed, territorial presence has been so vital that at points in history, places like the US, Germany, and Mexico have revoked the citizenship of naturalized members who moved abroad for too long. Citizenship by investment programs retain this territorial component, but they reconfigure it. It's not the person, but her money that must be resident for a defined period, typically contributing to the economy in the same way that labor might. Indeed, even if financial, this presence requirement is far stricter than the expectations of numerous programs for naturalizing the descendants of co-ethics or former state members. So in Italy, anyone with a male Italian ancestor can claim Italian citizenship. You don't even need to go to the country. And over 1 million people have done this. Same holds for Romania, where you don't even have to be Romanian, just the descendant of a former state member of any ethnicity. So states have long been great strategizers when it comes to citizenship. And we see increasingly that they are striving to draw into their ambit, though not always their territory, desired populations. When economic citizens allow their money to temporarily reside in the country, what do they get in exchange? The benefits that matter, much less rights the country grants gets within the state, but the advantages it secures outside it. As the proportion of the world's population crossing international borders grows, and as regional and bilateral agreements proliferate, the significance of these extraterritorial benefits increases too. What's the upshot for citizenship? Extraterritorial citizenship is Roman, not Athenian. The Civis Romanus Sum, the Apostle Paul's plea for a trial in Rome, that is the essence of citizenship by investment. In ancient Rome, citizenship didn't hinge on participation in the rule of the polity as it did in Athens. It was a privileged legal status, and just one of many in a multiplex empire. It was transportable. It followed the individual as he crossed the imperial domain. Its bearer was a member of a community of laws and subject to those laws, and could invoke them even when away. It is jurisdiction rather than democracy stood at its core. It is this version of citizenship that is ascendant in the contemporary world. Legalis Romanus is overtaking the zoon politikon, and in a time of de-democratization across the globe, it can be argued that the political animal is already a species, unfortunately, in decline. Investor citizens epitomize the shift away from an Athenian conception of citizenship to a more Roman version, a territorial